Where should I start? Maybe here. You remember that thing, my electronic load card link? Well, it's nice. I love it. I mean, but it has its limitation. And lately, I was doing a whole lot of measurements where I needed a real constant current load. So, maybe card link or just link to the videos. Yeah, there are some product reviews of DC-DC converters and stuff. So I thought one evening, okay, I built myself a small, simple, constant current DC electronic load. And I had that idea that I will fit it, in a case of, the size of a small multimeter, a pot to set the current, voltage display, current display, two jacks. Yeah, that's all. Keep it simple. And I already had, these wonderful Chinese instruments, 3 amps, 33 volts max. Also maybe card link in any case. Yeah, that's it. Simple as that. And just Googling around, or you can look at YouTube for it. I stumbled about that. This is just an example that came up on Google. So a simple electronic load by Mr. T.K. Harindran, also on Twitter and such with the handle T.K. Harindran. That was on www.cotray.com, link below. And perfect, isn't it? So, I started my project. Quite simple. So, I have a current regulation. Nothing fancy. An op amp, a shunt resistor, some MOSFET, and a set voltage input. That's it. Then I stumbled about that. Okay. Second op amp reserved for future use. So I couldn't do that, just use half of a chip. I mean, the main problem with a small constant current load is, of course, power dissipation. And I thought I go for something, aroundish 25 watts, passively cooled. And so the next step was to use that spare op amp to do a little power limitation circuit. Which in the end does nothing more than, diode here if you want, limit the set voltage to the current regulation. So basically limiting the current in relation to the voltage drop. So yeah, limiting the power here. You know, P equals I times V. Okay, now I was finished, I thought. But then, you know how my bench looks like at times, and sometimes you, you just mix up the cables, and reversing the polarity on that one. Remember, there is a diode in here. will basically cook that thing off completely. Or whatever device you are testing with your constant current load. So, we need a reverse voltage protection. Okay, and the simplest thing would be to use a Schottky diode, but then having a an additional voltage drop over here, a dynamic voltage drop, I cannot measure with my instrument, because obviously if there is really a Schottky diode here somewhere, you have to connect the ground of your instrument somewhere here, so you cannot measure the voltage drop across that thing, and that's even for Schottky a few hundred millivolts, and that was not acceptable to me. So forget about the Schottky and put in another MOSFET, this time, of course, the other way around. With another op-amp. And then I had another op-amp left. And I was thinking about maybe temperature alert limitation, but I thought, I'm really conservative with all the power calculations and my thermal resistance and cooling and so on. But just to give it some use, I made an battery warning. So, and that's now the not only the current regulation but also the current plan. And oops, I got a box full of parts. And I've got an idea for the circuit and current regulation, inverse voltage protection, power limitation, battery warning. Yeah, it's all there. And during the course of these videos, I will look at each part of the circuit in detail, and we will prototype it on a breadboard, of course. But before that, don't like having all my components hanging around the breadboard. That spells disaster. So first step would be to do some casework, and that's what I will do now. Here's the plan. Make enough holes in this case. It's from Hammond. I'll give you the type number shortly, which is exactly the size I wanted it to be. Yeah, I can put that away now. Make more holes at the back for power dissipation and attaching that heatsink, which will be cut down to size. I don't want that heavy, bulky thing here. Yeah, we will probably cut the two big fins at the side off, and yeah, also get it in height to exactly the height of the case, so that it's not sticking out anywhere. It looks nice. Yeah, and so we need a whole lot of holes here. And for all that, I have, of course, a plan, as always. So, just that you know, I'm using a Hammond 1599 EGY bat. So, 1599 E gray battery case. And yes, that thing has a battery case on, battery case, whatever, opening for battery in the back, which will be used for 9-volt battery and access to the fuse. Yeah, but I'm telling you already about the circuit, but yeah, it's unavoidable. So what's happening here? I need a hole for that ammeter voltmeter 4-digit. I need a hole for an on-off switch. I need a hole for a range switch. Yes, it will have two ranges. I'm sorry, couldn't stop myself. Was too easy to add. A hole for a 10-turn port and a hole for two holes for two plugs. And in addition, two holes for two LEDs, one bright red for a reverse voltage alert, and another maybe a mellow yellow for low battery warning. Yeah, that's it. And at the back side, which I will do first because it's the hardest part, at the back side I need three little 3mm holes for M3 screws, which will secure the heatsink to the back of the case with a little 5mm or 5.8mm standoff, so the heatsink is not touching the case. Did you see that? So the heatsink is not exactly touching the case, but there is an air gap. I also need one big cutout here to let some air here at the back where the shunt resistor will be located, and to let the cables in from the MOSFET that is attached to the heatsink. So, let's get started. So, I somehow was able to fixate that case with the side up to the desk, and I have here my brand spanking new, that is used about 30-year-old drill press, which I haven't closed up properly. And I cut out the drawing to scale for the side holes and the cutout, taped it to it, and now I will use a 1mm center drill to prime the holes, and then we go from there. And I will give you a total of the whole setup here. Yeah, my hands are big in just a second. For now, just let me drill. Yeah, turned out the shaft of the center drill is a little over 3 millimeters, which is the diameter I need for the three holes here. So I thought, yeah, can use as well the center drill. Okay, next step, I have to open up these holes. I can do with the drill press here up to 6 millimeters. So let me change the setup. So next step is 6 millimeter here for the big holes. They are not critical. I really need them only to get a saw blade or something in up here. I really need to replace the belt in that thing. Watch the video. I already put a link up. Okay, and now I give you a broad view. broad view of the whole setup. So, a piece of wood and two clamps hold the case to the desk. I used the drill press, rotated away from the base, which I loaded up with a few kilograms, maybe 10 pounds or more of transformers. And if you want to see that transformer in action, that high voltage transformer, watch the last Christmas video, card link. That's it. The rest I will probably have to do by hand. Yeah, before I continue with drilling, I just transfer my cutting lines with a box cutter to the case. Okay, now I can probably remove the paper. And I don't know about these holes, widening them up. I probably use that thingy here. And maybe, this is soft wood and soft plastic. Maybe I don't need even a drill. As I said, these holes are not critical at all. Yeah, that doesn't look too bad. Let's deburr these thingies from this side. I turned around the case on the jig and now, I fenced up the cutting I want to do now, and let's go make that first cut here to that hole. And the other side. The fencing really didn't work out that well for some reason. So I'm just cutting freehand now. Which is good enough. And now I need to cut back here. I need a small blade to do that. Let's take the blade directly from the saw. Okay, I guess I will take the file to it. It's not too pretty, but then the heatsink goes here, so nobody will ever see that again. I guess it doesn't look too bad. Now for the part that really should look good, and that is the front. Just as a sanity check, I cut out the front from my plan and put it to the case to see if really everything fits, and yeah, it doesn't look too bad, I'd say. Yeah, and yeah, the back also, it's okay. Now I will make a real drill plan for the back, just copy and pasting this in my not CAD tool, it's just Microsoft Visio. So I only have the lines here that I have to cut out. Last sanity check with the drill plan, and it still looks good. And you might notice that I have labeled the switches and the LEDs. The reason being, I will not tape that with Scotch tape to the case and then drill. But instead, I printed that also out on a self-adhesive transparency. yeah, that's the first time I'm trying that, but well, it will give a very nice front plate with the labels already on it, and yeah, let's see how that's working out. Let me cut that and then clean up the case with some alcohol and wash my hands, which are a little bit gritty, and then let's see if we can get that on here without any bubbles and such. That went exceptionally well, but for the fact that I put it on upside down. This fucking stinks. Oh, no. It's actually not too hard to get up. Okay. Second try. Well, the second time it's on in the right direction, but yeah, I think the first time went better, or maybe, yeah, I have to review the video stuff, but yeah, it's still good enough. It has some kind of Chinese quality feeling to it. Okay, next stop, drilling and cutting. I do hope that, yeah, this self-adhesive transparency will not lift up when I'm drilling. We will see how it goes. The surface of the ABS is a little bit rough, so yeah, you saw how easy it was to remove my first failed try attempt from the case again. Yeah, let's give it a try. Yeah, that lifted stuff up a bit, but maybe it's can be saved. We'll see. And that was my first belt, but I have two more of these leather belts. Now I have only one spare belt left, because one of the two spare leather belts, 30 year olds, that came with that thingy, it broke as soon as I tried to put it on the pulley. So let's see. Okay, there is a little hole back here. I don't know. You can probably not see it. Here. And I have to look up what that diameter is and put in another centered drill for that purpose. So I needed 1.6 millimeter for that hole, and I got a center drill with 1.6 millimeters, so everything's well. So all what's left to do is to widen up the holes to here a full 6 millimeter. Let's see how this goes. If I hold this down, yeah, that's not working. Okay. It was just an idea, you know. I need to go to 10 millimeters. I have to look up the diameter for that hole and these two. So 10.44 according to the manufacturer of the 10 ton pot that will go in here. So let's go up to 10. I don't have a 10.44 drill. And what did I say? 7? Okay, so 6 should be no problem. Seven, I need a drill. Maybe I use a drill for that, huh? And that was the drilling part, at least from this side. Yeah, I guess this stuff would stick to a really smooth surface much better, like you have a, on a metal case. But not really. It was just an idea I had, and you have to try new things, don't you? Yeah, that's all. Reasonably well deburred where it has to be deburred. Can do a little bit on the back side. Oh, well, it doesn't look too bad. Yeah, oh, there is something missing. That's better. So, next stop would be sawing out the three holes here, and then I guess a lot of fitting and filing, huh? Let's start with the biggest one, huh? I need some additional light, otherwise I can't see the lines. Much better. That was easy. The main reason I'm not using my Proxon drill with a cutting blade or a Dremel is I made in another project, maybe called Link. I had a bad experience because if you cut with a cutting blade or a miniature saw blade with high RPM, that ABS plastic, it melts. And it doesn't look nice, okay? So let's get the part that should go in here and put the file to it. Perfect fit. I don't know. Might be a wee bit off. Or am I dreaming that? No, I'm not dreaming that. Yeah, that's more like it. First hole done, two more to go, but I have to change the setup. Let's do this. Oh, these holes are small. Ah, that's it, almost. Yeah. Yeah, these holes don't have to be beautiful because, they will be covered up. I should check if the pot is fitting and the two connectors and, of course, the LED stuff. And, that was not that good, but good enough. So the connectors, they have a little, can you see that? Can I have a focus here? Obviously not, a little nick, so they don't turn. And I need to put that nick in there. Perfect. Let's test fit the diodes here to the LEDs. Yeah, they fit just fine. Perfect. All that's left to do is clean up the edges and the inside just a wee bit. And I just noticed, can you see that? It would have been a better idea to file that from the inside because, maybe I do a little bit more clean up off camera, but for now, that's it. Now I just have to clean up the mess and we can have a look at the finished product. Yeah, I forgot to test fit the pot. I remember there's a half a millimeter missing here in diameter, so that's it. Now I clean up. And there it is, the finished product. And I put it together wrong. This way. Battery case to the bottom, of course. Functional. So next step would be to machine this big heatsink down to a size so it would fit at the back. But I'll do that another day. Till then, bye.